G'day.
I'm Glenn Martin, and I've been teaching astrophotography to beginners since 2017. So in this video, I'm going to be showing you a very, very condensed version of what I teach in my workshops around what basic settings you'll use for your camera gear. So the settings I'm about to tell you, they will work with any DSLR or mirrorless camera and most lenses as long as they're nice and wide. Okay, so we don't want to be using 50mm, 100mm, not at this level. I want you to get out there and be able to get under the night sky, point your camera up there and get stars within a few minutes. If you follow these steps, I'm pretty much going to guarantee you this is going to be possible. So first things first, we want to be in manual mode. Forget auto mode, forget the priority modes. In priority mode, the camera's got no idea what you're trying to do, pointing up into a pitch black sky. With your aperture, you want your aperture generally as wide as your lens will go. So f3.5, f2.8, depending on your lens that you have. You can even get away with f4. So your ISO. ISO, let's start at 3200. Now, if you've got a camera that's say more than 10 years old, it may not go to 3200, or at ISO 3200, the noise is so severe, it really starts drowning out the stars. So you might want to go to ISO 1600. Remember, these are starting points. As you get to know your gear, you can go up and down in your ISO and have a play around. But we're going to start at 3200 ISO. So shutter speed. This is how long you're going to expose the camera to the stars to get a decent image in the back. Let's just start at 15 seconds. So as long as you've got a lens that's at least 24mm wide on a full frame camera, or if you've got an APS-C crop sensor camera, a lens that's 18mm or wider. 15 seconds is going to be a really great place to start. It's going to be bright enough that you'll get an image of the stars and hopefully not so long that the stars actually start to visibly trail. This is why we don't shoot for a minute at a time, for example, because if you point your camera up to the sky, shoot for a minute, it's going to be lovely and bright, but you're going to get these arcs in the image. You won't have pinpoint stars anymore. And when I'm talking exposures of 15 seconds, don't fall into the newcomer's trap of actually setting your camera to 1/15th of a second. That's the 1/15. So what you actually want to do is when you're slowing your shutter down and you get to that 15, actually keep on going. Keep scrolling that wheel until you see a little inches appear, and now that is your camera telling you that you're in seconds. So scroll it out to 15 seconds, and now we've got a long enough exposure to be able to really bring out those stars in the sky and maybe any color up there if you're pointing at the Milky Way, for example. Other settings that are useful in the back of your camera, to set your camera to RAW at the very least. Now, if you're not somebody who's shooting in RAW generally or processing your images, you're not comfortable with Lightroom or Photoshop, etc., RAW plus JPEG. So the JPEG, the camera will process the image for you. Depending on your camera and the settings that you have, it may or may not do a decent little output, but make no mistake, a 16 million color image in JPEG is nothing against a 4 billion color RAW file where you've got so much more that you can do in your processing. White balance. I like to set my white balance manually. Around 4000 Kelvin is a decent temperature, not too warm and golden, but not so blue that it's cold. But honestly, if you're shooting in RAW, you have complete control over white balance anyway, so it doesn't really matter. Although when you're previewing your images as you're shooting, that white balance will affect whether you're seeing a golden image or more blue image. It's aesthetics, but it's just, you know, we're removing those barriers. And the last little handy setting for you is hopefully you've got a remote trigger. If you don't have a trigger yet though, you can set your camera to a 2 second or 10 second delay for the photo. The difference being really is your tripod. So if you've got a strong, stable carbon fiber tripod like this Surui that I have here, a 2 second delay is usually enough. But if you've got a cheaper tripod, an aluminium tripod, that's right, I said aluminium, but if you've got an aluminium tripod, especially lightweight travel ones, they can be really unstable. So no matter how gentle you are, you're going to have this tripod shake going through there, which is going to affect the outcome of your images. So you want a 10 second delay if you're using those sorts of tripods. So if you've got a remote trigger, you don't have to set a delay to your shutter. I prefer to use a simple corded trigger. This is a Harnell brand. It's a generic brand. You can get them for all types of cameras. And I prefer corded triggers over wireless or Bluetooth or infrared because although while they are handy when they work, when they're not working, they are just such a pain and they're really, really frustrating. And I guarantee you they will stop working at that time when you really need them the most. So these normal corded triggers is my recommendation. So lenses, let's talk about lenses. On a full frame camera, you want a lens that's at least 24 mil or wider. And on an APS-C or crop sensor camera, you want a lens that's at least 18 mil or wider. This has to do with how long that you can expose for before you start getting obvious star trails in your image. So the wider the lens, the better. When you've got your lens, if it's got image stabilization, vibration control, or whatever variation it has, depending on the brand that you're in, turn it off. So you want image stabilization turned off in the lens because when it's on a tripod, it doesn't need that floating element because there's no movement to counteract against. And by having image stabilization on in the lens, you can actually end up with blurry images when you're using a tripod. So turn that off. With your focus, generally you will be using manual focus. Sometimes, depending on your lens and camera combo, using autofocus, you can get an initial focus point off the stars, but as soon as you move the camera and reposition it, you go to hit that shutter, it will hunt for focus again and will often lose it. So generally start on manual focus. And just to talk about focusing for you, I am going to do another video talking about the five different ways that you can focus for astrophotography, but the one I find I have most success with is if you follow these steps. First, you want to find the brightest star or planet, you know, maybe Mars is in the sky, and point your camera at it, get it into the middle of the frame. So zoom your lens in, and in live view on the back, go to 10 times live view so you can see the star in the back of your screen. Now, if you can't see anything, by the way, if your camera is sitting for a close focus, for example, all the stars will be so defocused, it's like there's nothing in the sky. If you take your camera to infinity, you should at least see something, and then from there, you can follow on now with the next step. So once you can see a star, what you're going to do is slowly rock the focus back and forth. So while you're watching your viewfinder and you're looking at the star, so you'll be in focus, but then go out of focus, come back the other way, in and out again, and just rock back and forth, smaller, 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 looking at this star. And your goal is to get the dot as small as possible. And as you're rocking in smaller, smaller rotations, you're going to build up like this mental model of what feels sharp or what feels the smallest, and you're just going to end up there. And that should at least get you some sharp stars. You can take a test photo and have a look, and if it does look too blurry or too thick, just go through that process again. Just spend 15 minutes just doing a bit of shooting, getting something into the camera. After 15 minutes, refocus again. Now, there is a risk that you go from a good focus to a bad one, but you'll shoot for another 15 minutes and then refocus again. So then hopefully we come back to good. It's all about practice, and focusing for astro, especially for DSLR and mirrorlesses, that can be a pretty frustrating part of astrophotography. So just get your practice in, stick with it, and just keep at it. Let's talk tripods. So tripods, with astrophotography, you're as only as good as the weakest link in your ecosystem, and that is often the tripod for most people. If you haven't invested in a good quality, sturdy tripod, you may have something that's a bit light, doesn't carry a heavy payload. This can definitely affect your outcome. So if you do have a smaller, lightweight tripod, red hot tip, don't extend the final leg segments. This is generally the smallest, thinnest, weakest part of your tripod, so leave them packed in and extend your thicker legs. This is especially important if you've got four or even five leg segments, because even though they become quite compact, the more they go out, the thinner they get. Another hot tip for you is if you have a center column that you can rise up like this, don't. Unfortunately, even though with these smaller tripods, it generally means you're down low and it's a bit uncomfortable, so you want to raise this center column. In doing that, you now have removed the strength of the three axis of stability of what a tripod offers. So honestly, you really need to leave your center column down. And the last hot tip, if you do have a tripod with a hook under the center column, you can hang your camera bag off it or some other similar heavyweight. This will pull down and really increase the stability of your tripod. Just do be mindful though that if it is a little bit windy and that weight is swaying underneath the tripod, again, we're removing what the tripod is doing for you. So just be conscious of that. If nothing else, you can maybe lower the tripod so your bag is just sitting on the ground but still having weight down on the tripod itself. So there we go, there's my basic settings for any camera that you can use to get your own photos of the stars. It's really not that hard, and honestly the hardest part is getting out somewhere dark. But you're now armed with what you need to know that if you do get into those conditions, you'll be able to get your own photos. And honestly, the first time you get your first decent photo of the stars, in particular the Milky Way if it's still up, it's just such a great feeling when you see it in the back of your camera. But won't be held responsible for any little rabbit holes or addiction that you now go down as a result. Have a great day.